So these numbers are from the month of May. I don't have citation numbers, it's pretty routine for me. I wish I had a good, I'd do a better job with that. But our systems are going from paper citations to automated citations. Last month, I was able to give a count of over the last 2 months, but it was, it took me 2 days to like count with my fingers, so. With that being said, we are out. Me and Mary and I were just talking about that. I rotate between Sierra Highway, Bokeh Canyon, and San Francisco. And I do county enforcement for crossing with the VL lines and the speed. So if you guys are connected to our Facebook, there's posts. As soon as I get done, I usually send my stats and a picture of the person I pulled over to our Facebook coordinator, which is our public relations guy, and he'll post it. So if you guys are attached to it, you'll see how often that we're out there. We've been absolutely hammering that area.
We are thankful for every single issue.
I'll tell you this too. Last Thursday, I was out there Wednesday and Thursday, and I sit southbound at the Shin. If you ever did it, when that's at, it's a fantastic area because downhill and it's a passing lane. So what happens is there are people that are stuck in that line of vehicles. They try to pass 10 cars at 90 plus, and I'm literally just sitting at the bottom. And we've also been several times we've had up to 6 vehicles. I'm standing outside the car just shooting LIDAR and just calling out speeds, and there's more officers in traffic sometimes, so it's really good. Last week, the highest speed I got was 74, which was fantastic. I was shocked. That area, it's common in the morning to get, you know, 80, sometimes 90. It got 103, which that was a big like world news, I think.
Yeah.
And just to give you an idea too, it's not like she was like flying at 103 for the whole stretch of Sierra Highway, although it sounds like that. It's just the brief moment when she had an opportunity to pass, I was sitting right there. And then also, I'll see the passing lane, so I see two sets of headlights coming out there at 5 in the morning, sometimes 4:30. And then sometimes I see a third. That third means they're over the WL lines. And I've made several arrests out there based off of speed and crossing over WL lines where I've impounded the vehicle into the jail for reckless driving. So that has happened too out there. That's kind of my report for the citations. But as far as the arrests, there was 55 arrests for the whole entire Newhall area. 2 were felony, 53 were misdemeanor, mostly due to DUI. As far as the Ogallala State area, there was 15 arrests, 13 were DUI misdemeanor, and then 2 were felony, they're drug possession. And drug possession is pretty tricky because they've changed a lot of our laws where half the time it's just a cycle of abuse, misdemeanor, not a felony. But we did get 2 felony drug possessions out of last month. As far as collisions go, it was pretty light, which is good. There's only 184 collisions in the Newhall area. 184. And there were 16 collisions within the Ogallala area. 10 were damage, or property damage only, and 3 were injury. And the injury were just complaint of pain. There was 1 fatal, and it happened on the 14th freeway. It was a solo, unsafe turning movement, and the vehicle rolled. As far as events that are coming up, we're still doing the speed enforcement. That's gonna be a common thing as much as I can get out there. I try to get out there twice a week, but at least once a week. And then if anybody has a teenage driver, or maybe pre-driver, like 15 and up, we're gonna have a Start Smart class. And that's gonna be on June 23rd at 11 o'clock at our office. And it's a really good class. My son just turned 16 this past week, and I'm going to bring him and a couple of his buddies down too, and I hear it's really, really good. So that again is on June 23rd. It's at 11 o'clock at our office, and if you want to attend or you have someone that wants to attend, they just have to call the office and get their name on the roster. That's about as easy. Then if anyone needs the number, I can give it to you now. It's 661-294-5540, and they go over. It's about an hour and a half class. They go over the responsibilities of driving, and as a year to date, the leading cause of teenage fatalities are collisions. It's not anything else. It's collisions. So they talk about that kind of stuff too. So, and that's about it.
Is there anything about speed limit in town?
just see rocking chairs and people drinking coffee happening. It seems to be pretty nice over here. I don't know, like, but anyway, that's all I have.
Thank you.
We don't have a Los Angeles County resident deputy yet.
We have, maybe we do, yeah.
Cool. Let's have it. Los Angeles County Sheriff, resident deputy. This is a happy day.
Yes. Welcome.
How are you?
Good.
So, well, a, just quick background, name's Joe Silva, been on the department 18 years. Recently came out here a month ago on the transfer kicked in on the 13th of May. And CHP's delivery was much better, but between acting on the real estate with traffic, it is absolute madness out here. So with that being said, to go along with his, I went through CHP's radar course about 2 weeks ago, so I got certified through CHP to run radar. I have to wait for an 8-hour LiDAR class so I can shoot that, because when I came out here, like I said, traffic was the main issue. So I sat on Sierra Highway by La Chen also, Escondido, Soledad Canyon, just basically everywhere, and the main thing is passing like CHP said. So I don't have any radar unit yet to run speed, but I take whatever I can get. But the last one I had to go along with what he said in front of La Chen, basically at our county line is Sierra Vallejo Road. And then after that, it turns into Santa Cruz Airport. But with that passing lane, it was the same thing. I saw a car come out, the dust on the road, basically this lady creates her own lane. I stop her in front of La Chen, and she is unlicensed, no insurance, and somehow I am the bad guy. So she was cited for all three, and yeah, the only thing I didn't do was park book her on the suspended license, but her car went to jail, and she got a ride from somebody. So. But with that being said, for the stats that I have, we didn't have any concrete stuff in June, since we're still kind of in the middle. But for May, there's only 14 incidents out here in Agua. There was one burglary, one grand theft. There was two non-aggravated assaults. There was one felony vandalism, one petty theft, one misdemeanor. Yeah, three non-criminal and two miscellaneous, and somehow it's on here twice. So basically, there was five non-criminal reports. So compared to Acton, it's much quieter out here. But yeah, mm-hmm. That's what we have. So.
Right. Okay. Sounds good.
Welcome to the community.
Thank you for coming tonight. I appreciate it. And we have an email.
If I could have one more thing.
You bet. Scott used to take half an hour.
I know Scott. He's a great guy. He gave me the shirt off his back, but I'm not Scott, and I do things slightly different. But whatever number you have for Scott, please disregard. I don't know if he had a cell phone or an extension at the station, but I came in. I don't have a cell phone. That extension went to someone else. And I'm getting emails from people that don't even work in the North County that are calling random numbers, and I get the email and I go, I think this is for you. Yeah. Okay. So the best way to do it, I talk to the operator at the station. So if there's something that I can do, you can call the station. The operator will email me directly, and that's a better way to get it. They gave me a mailbox at the station. They didn't tell me about it, and when I finally did, there was notes in there. And so I am trying to catch up to everything that I have going.
And you live in the area here?
I do. I'm an athlete.
Great. Super. Well, thank you very much. Appreciate your service.
Okay. Does anybody need the station number?
We do have the black number.
I don't.
We have a lot of difficulty having the short going to the station to advise
right.
you. And by the time it advises, it's a long
time. Well, that's what I say, because the notes that I've gotten, I between the time you retired and I came on, there's, like I said, I have had stacks of notes and everything else. And when I asked about his direct line, that apparently he could check from home and do different things, the second he left, the station went and it went to somebody else.
Is that right? Okay.
So,
you need to get one of them.
I asked about that. I I said, hey, I said, this number? I said, where is this phone at? And they go, what's the extension? And I tell them, they go, no, that went to the Explorers.
Okay.
And I go, but the Explorers are never here. And
right, but you need your own.
You do.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's gonna have to come from somebody way above my
head. That's the letter that we wrote.
Okay.
To
yes.
say.
And give this man a line.
Okay.
All right. Make sure that happens.
So.
First of all, there's.
They'll take all of us out here and connect it with that there so that anywhere here before you drop in Palmdale, we go this direction. But who's to say? Until we get to that point. We'll see.
Right.
All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Yes.
Los Angeles County Fire Department. Yes, sir.
Appreciate the fast response to that. It was amazing to see all the resources, the boss check drops, the sky cranes. It was awesome.
Great. That was what
we're here to do.
Yeah.
Happy we were able to do it well for you.
Appreciate
it. Have you figured out the cost of fire?
The cost of fire?
The cost of fire?
There's some indication that there was some work going on Pacific Crest Trail.
Oh.
And some sparks. As you know, your grass is very volatile, it's very receptive to any sparks or heat. So it's increasingly important to have that clearance around your homes. And that is the greatest portion of protection to your home to save it, is the clearance that you do beforehand, even more so than the fire engine being right there. Okay, that clearance will do a lot more than what a fire engine can do. Okay?
Yep. Thank you.
As far as activities in the month of May, this is what Maria had provided for me. There were a total of 26 responses in Agua Dulce. 16 of those were medical. There was one fire, it was a vehicle fire. Obviously, the stone fire will be on June's report. Of those responses, 16 persons were seen for medical responses as patients, and about 9 were transported. About half the count, ALS, or advanced life support, was needed, and others were just basic life support. Okay. The activities going on this month, I don't know how often it gets up into this area, unless the jet stream's carrying it this way, but there could be some smoke on days that we are able to conduct some training. That goes on annually in the month of June, but it's over on the Wayside Detention Center, where we do wildland training to train some of our newly promoted personnel in their new skill sets and responsibilities. It was scheduled all week. We haven't had a single day of it because of the fire in Santa Clarita this week and just the weather. We haven't been able to have it. That being said, if the weather is favorable, say like next week, it is possible that they'll have that. And you may see some smoke in the air. I don't want that to preclude you from calling and inquiring at the dispatch center.
west of you, that could put some smoke up. They generally keep it very minimal, so I'd be surprised if it got this way. Again, our weather patterns can vary, and that jet stream that comes from onshore certainly can carry things this way. So, as you all know. Did you all have any questions for me before I conclude? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I just wanted you to take back to Chief Massey that Maria did a great job of updating the Disaster Planning Committee on the fire as it was occurring.
Okay.
So we get that information out immediately on our web page.
Okay, I will pass that on to him, and I will say that we're very happy to have Maria working with us, and the work that she does has been just fantastic. So she's been quite a bit of help to us, as well as to you as the community. So after June, I would imagine, I don't know what date she's coming back to work with, so certainly be an access point for you as well.
Thank you.
You all have a
wonderful
day.
Thank you very much, appreciate you coming out.
Thanks, Gary, for updating that page.
Oh, absolutely.
Next up, we have, let's see, Acton on Wilson Library, report from librarian Jim Wall.
Thank you for your email.
Of course, a lot of attachments on this one, see, can I say? Lots of good stuff. So first thing, it's that time of year again. I want to tell everyone to come and sign up for our summer reading program, summer discovery program. It's now available. You can come on into the library. I've got programs for as little as babies, 1 month old, 2 months old, activities you can do with them, all the way through adults. The children's names, baby, children, and teen. I have game programs that you pick up cards in the library for. For all ages, there's a program online. You sign up through our website for read books, you get prizes, all kinds of things. Well worth the sign up. Come on by, say hi. In other news, you may have noticed on the attachments I sent you, or if you've seen anything on libraries, Facebook, or anything, that we have a new logo. We're going through a little bit of a rebranding right now. It used to be we were County of Los Angeles Public Library. We're now re-identified, rebranded as just LA County Library. Kind of help differentiate ourselves from the city library. Surprise how confused people get. And I think the thing that most library employees are happy about is we have a new website, a new web address. Your old bookmarks still work. It just was a horrible thing to try and spell out every time somebody I had to literally spell it out. Our new website, it's just lacountylibrary.org. I can look at you, I can say it, and you can go, oh, okay. The old one, cola, helps live, everyone goes, what? No more of that. I can actually just tell you what our website is now. So, but don't worry, if you have old things bookmarked, they still will work. It just redirects to the new website. Speaking of the website, in the coming weeks, the whole thing is actually going to go through a restructuring and get a whole new web page coming up soon too. So keep an eye out for that in the coming weeks. And you'll hear me talk about it in the future, I'm sure. Programs happening in the library. Some good stuff that is coming out. So on the 21st, we actually have a personal safety workshop. It's geared towards children and their caregivers. So there'll be a section of this workshop where they talk with the kids and the parents all in the room about things, safety and things like that. And then the children will be taken out of the room, and there's a section of it just for parents. It's a little bit more real content. So definitely recommend people come by that. That's Thursday the 21st of June. Let's see here. A couple days later on the 25th, we're having our Micromobile come back to the library. That's always lots of fun. He's always got all kinds of great things for all ages to do. We've got them coming back for kids. They're making boats, and they're going to test them in the water and see which kid can go with the boat that goes the farthest. Bringing in some little tropical
towel. Oh.
Yeah. Otherwise, yes.
There's a lake that we didn't know about.
Yeah. So it runs right under the library. That's how I know you haven't come. That should be lots of fun. I do also have something I want to share. I've got an investment fraud prevention workshop coming. I've got someone from the state coming to talk about the different scams that are going on and how to protect yourself against someone calling with investment fraud. So that should be a really good program. Should be interesting. more people than I can even get in there. I get waitlists, but it doesn't matter because everyone shows up. We'll be starting a new session of that in July too, so keep an eye posted. Sign up will be required because it is so popular. But that'll be starting up on the 23rd of July. New session of that. Other than that, lots of other programming going on. Check the website, check my flyers. Unless anyone's got any questions or concerns. That's all I got.
Thank you very much.
I'm not gonna bore you for hours.
Thank you very much. Next up, we have 5th District Report from Rosalyn Wayman, who is not with us tonight.
Absent.
She's absent. We also have California Assembly District 38 Report from Assemblyman Dante Acosta. Shannon's not here.
She's absent also.
She's absent.
Calls on the job.
Okay. So now I move to the presentation discussion portion of our meeting. We have a presentation from Santa Cruz Valley Locations. I'm going to discuss a feature film at the Ogallala Airport. Karen Bright has asked them for some time to make her presentation. Karen?
Hi.
Hi.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to come talk with you. I'm Karen Bright. I'm the owner and president of SCV Locations. As Don said, we represent and manage the filming that goes on out at the airport. And throughout this summer, we have the opportunity to bring a quite impressive feature film to the airport. And I can give you the basics from the airport side, but I have asked actually my location managers for the production to come this evening and actually give you real accurate information rather than information that I'm translating on their behalf.
Okay.
So what I can share with you about airport, because I know that it is a concern, is as far as the airport function, what it means to the community is during the production and the construction of the sets, and while the production is actually present at the airport will be closed to the general public. That means that all of the air traffic that has been in the community that is not local hangar owners to the Ogallala or tenants to the Ogallala Airport, they will not be able to fly in at will. Actually, they won't be able to fly in at all. The airport will be closed to the public.
When is that?
This is, the proposed dates are June 25th through October.
To October?
Right now it's approximately October 25th, but again, I leave it to Robert to give you specifics because he has a calendar. During that period of time, I want to be very clear. The airport being closed to the general public does not mean that the airport will be closed to the tenants or the hangar owners of the airport. The activities of our tenants and our hangar owners will be coordinated, and they will be able to use their aircraft. They will be able to fly with coordination. And I say coordination out of safety. Okay, so that is the. I know that that has been an area of concern, that no one will be able to come and go, and that is not quite the case.
Another area of concern is going back to last week with the fire.
Yes.
The airport was used.
Yes, it was. That was my next thing.
Okay.
So
and that's a high fire danger that those months.
That is correct. So the during, it was actually quite, it was a good experience for all. During that activity, we actually had our construction crew for a production working at the airport, laying out, taking measurements to see where the set will sit. And the helicopter started to arrive. We pulled the crew off of the areas that they were working, and the helicopters continued to go. It was quite impressive and fascinating to watch the helicopters, the circles, and then we had, I think at one point, we had 5 or 6 different helicopters that were coming and going. Those landing zones, one of them will be relocated, which has actually been in the process for quite some time. So what will happen is the 2 landing areas for the helicopters to fill up. One will stay exactly where it is because it is at the opposite end of the airport. And the second one
southwest?
It's essentially each end of the runway.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Does anybody have any questions?
I'm curious as to where that is.
Well, it's actually.
It's the end of the runway. Where's the landing zone gonna be?
At the end of four.
At the end of four? Because the other one's over by the taxi.
Beginning of four.
Beginning.
South.
Yeah, at the four. Is that where you're talking about?
Correct, so at the.
At number four.
I apologize, I don't know the numbers of the hangars.
No, it's a hangar, that's. Okay.
Down by Charlie's hangar.
Is there a fire pit in that?
It's essentially a fire pit.
The hangars are all behind.
On the hangars.
And they're every so many feet.
And there is an open space next to Charlie.
That is correct.
So they just wanna make those.
So it's over on the taxiway side, no?
And the other one is gonna relocate to the hydrant?
Yeah.
So the two in the middle are gonna be gone?
The two in the middle, I will be honest with you, the two in the middle were never actually supposed to be designated as fire hydrants for that purpose. They were supposed to be on both ends. And so the airport has been working with the fire department, because in no way, I wanna make it very clear, in no way, from what has been communicated to me, do we have any intention of taking that away. That is a vital, vital asset to this community, and something that I know the owner of the airport is proud and happy to be able to provide. So that is not going away. And we have had much discussion with our production friends, and they understand and agree that clearly, in an emergency circumstance, when life and safety and, you know, humanity is at risk, humanity takes precedent, not us. So.
Can I just ask you one question? I'm confused about, these people work for.
No. Okay, they work for me. They work for 20th Century Fox.
Right.
Yes.
And you're like the industry person that sets up these.
That is correct. My company is a management company, a film management company. We've been in business for 17 years.
And when they're here.
Yes.
Do they have somebody in charge, or how is that all gonna work?
As far as.
With the pilots.
Yes, we actually have a couple of things that we are working on setting up. And there will be, when we go along, and I was actually going to, and this is, I guess, more airport stuff, I had actually intended to invite all of the hangar owners to come and sit and chat with me, and so that we could talk about, how the movie and our tenants can work in conjunction.
That would be nice.
It was, but you're starting on the 25th now of June. I mean, that's like right around the corner.
Correct.
We
haven't had any word on that.
I guess we should tell you straight out, we've had issues already.
Yeah.
Already.
With your production people.
With your production.
The ones drawing those lines, they were out of control.
And not only that.
I'm sorry, I was there when they were drawing the lines.
Well, all I know is that there was a pilot trying to take off, that they noticed there was a huge issue. The pilot's very upset. The person on the ground giving direction to the film company was not strong enough in supporting the pilot. He was pretty much.
Was this one rigged?
The communication.
That was a different production.
That was a different production.
Oh,
that was a completely different production.
But there is something.
The communication between the pilot and Jerry and the production company broke down.
Okay.
Because I believe that between Jerry and the production company, there was an issue.
And that was a big issue.
Yeah, absolutely.
And see, and this is, I'm actually very, very happy to be hearing this feedback from all of you. Because I haven't been on the receiving end of any of the issues, and so I wasn't aware that there were some.
It was just a breakdown.
Okay.
And the pilot didn't think they were ready to go, and the production company didn't know that they were going, and so it was that in between.
Okay. So to answer your question, to try to figure out how to work with you individually or as a group. Because I know that there are a lot of our hangar owners that I've never seen those hangars open in 3 years. And there are a lot of owners that I've seen. And there are a lot of hangars that our pilots are there often, frequently. So.
And how are you closing the airport for 4 months to outside traffic?
From what I understand, and I don't, that's not part of what I do.
Okay.
So the information that I know is that a NOTAM is sent out.
Wait, you can't X runways now.
I apologize, I don't know if they're, I don't know about runways.
Because we can't use
right. If a NOTAM is issued, X's should go down and then it really is closed.
Okay.
Nobody should be taken off.
That's something we need to investigate.
Yeah.
If you X runways, I don't think we can go in.
Right, so it needs to be restricted.
So
it is restricted, not closed. So the NOTAM needs to indicate that, that it's open for
prior approval.
No, because that way then you could get prior approval for somebody flying in.
That could be done.
And that can be
correct.
Done.
That could be done.
So it needs to be restricted, not closed.
Okay. So again, and this is great information for me as well, because now
what we don't want to see is two yellow X's at the end of the runways on June 25th.
At the I have not at any of the discussions that we've had have heard anyone mention putting the X's down on the line.
Okay.
I do know what those are, and I have not heard that mentioned.
Okay.
But there is at some point where you will shut down the airport.
There are several days in October during filming only, and those you will receive notice of those. And I believe that, again, I don't know the exact number of days, and I will let Robert address that.
11 days.
Those are the actual shows.
Over 2 weeks.
Correct. 2 weeks ahead. Those are the actual filming.
Yes.
Okay, so we've run into this problem actually on several occasions now.
Okay.
We fly our plane so that we can get up to my very elderly parents, et cetera, like that.
Okay.
So it's a very functional flying, it's very critical to our life. And the only two times we needed to go out when there was production, because we generally have worked around it, both times got screwed up. Actually, rather bad. One time we came in the fire, we never did get an answer. We had to land, even though it had been all prearranged, we had to land right in the middle of the planes taking off. And the second time, the helicopter blocked us from going off the production crew. So we need absolute guaranteed guidelines about how we get in and out. And we need to be able to get in and out, not with 11 down days or anything like that. Now, I personally don't care if you tell me 7 to 8 is a good time to go out or whatever, to come back or something like that. Most of the time, that's quite doable.
Okay.
But we have to have absolute guidelines, because we pay a fortune for that place. And in addition to that, some of it is very integral to our life.
Okay.
So that's very important.
Yep.
Yes.
Is there anybody here that has any concerns other than the people that use the airport for air traffic? Well, because I think it sounds to me like the issue, for some reason, it hasn't been presented to the pilots, which is a little, concerning. But we also need to consider who else is concerned. Obviously, it sounds to me like there needs to be a meeting with the pilots or the hangar owners.
And you.
Okay. And then the other is, other than the flying hindrance, people that might be concerned. So I think, and the gentleman that you brought, does he have a portion that he wants to present also, and then we want to open up to other concerns, or how do you want to handle this? It's your time.
How about if I just answer your question?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now you need to indicate that.
Okay.
Yes.
Is there going to be an increase in air traffic?
No, there is not.
Okay.
There will be a significant decrease.
Question.
Yes.
Hypothetical, I don't know this person, but let's say he flies out of Van Nuys, lives in Agua Dulce, and comes to Agua Dulce. You're telling him he can't come because he's not a hangar owner?
Correct.
He's going to lose some people.
Correct.
And you live in Agudoce?
Yes.
And you fly to Agudoce?
Yes.
But you're telling me you can't for 4 months because you don't want to hang out in Agudoce?
That is correct.
That's correct.
That's correct.
Yeah, that doesn't fly. Okay, thank you for answering.
I think the point there is that it isn't just, I mean, while we understand, you know, everybody's going to make a living and we certainly support you in doing that, but we would expect that reciprocal care for our lives and our businesses and our that. Many people occasionally do use this airport for probably, in this case, business operations and such, regular users who may not strictly be hangar owners, but they probably need to be accommodated in a similar way. And I'm sure there's ways of doing that, but they do need to be addressed. Another one, a concern of mine, and maybe we'll do it, is are you going to be actually shutting the runway down and making it unusable?
No.
Okay.
No, the runway will not be unusable.
So this airport is a little bit unique in the area. It is the only airport in quite some distance. It is an airport that lies at a very strange weather terminus between the Antelope Valley and the Southern California, and that numerous friends of mine, numerous people have had to emergency put into this airport. It's not really a choice. They're not people out there. And if you don't have some sort of method for accepting them on an emergency basis, not a my airplane's on fire basis, but I really need to land now basis, that also could place people's lives in danger. We are a reliever airport in a unique way because of that. You know, there's some planes that just cannot get into the Antelope Valley because of the winds, and they have to put in here. So my concern is that, and hopefully if you have a single person who's dedicated to this, we can work that through, and they can make some realistic judgment calls about, you know, friendly warning people away. But as you well know, you know, a very fundamental tenet of flying is that you land, be damned, and that needs to be, that could be a lot better than what would ensue into a fight in a very dangerous situation.
That is actually, emergency situations have been talked about and addressed, and the discussion that happened was essentially what you said, is that person will have a radio, they call, they're listening, and in that circumstance, the runway, we will do everything that we can to accommodate in an emergency circumstance.
And that person will be directly connected to
the airport.
I guess I meant directly connected to the film production company. I think
there's
been some concern with the current airport representative and their structure, their relationship with the production companies. We had a very, very dangerous situation where a production pilot, a helicopter pilot, did some, what in my opinion was very, very, very dangerous behavior. And it seemed to stem from their belief that they owned the airport at that time because they had paid their money.
Okay.
Along with the airport coordinator not really doing a very strong job at that production company, and what ended up being a, you know, a reportable near miss, and I didn't report it to the NTSB.
Okay.
So we certainly want to avoid that kind of thing again. That they, you know, they entered runway space with our priority on there. It was really dangerous.
So was this, were we actively filming? Was the airport closed that day?
It was at NOTAM. It was sort of prearranged in much in the way that you're suggesting that this would happen. And those arrangements were made, and we entered the runway. And at that time, the helicopter then entered the runway after we had already taken that runway, and then proceeded to do some very close maneuvering over the top of our aircraft and refused to leave. And the comment was, this is my airport. So it was dangerous. It was really unprofessional. It's upsetting, and it isn't unique. So we want to make sure that we have a very direct line to the production company, and that they have some real understanding that
ignored it.
He ignored it. He knew. We were speaking to him on the radio.
Well, you were speaking to him or Jerry?
To the pilot.
To the pilot as well as to Jerry. Jerry on his telephone, the pilot on the radio, and the pilot told us. He superseded us in all ways, even though we had cleared, we had already got the runway. His engine was not even on when he started to enter the runway. Fired up.
So this is all very eye-opening information for me, and I will address it.
We're a little shy.
I do.
And don't get us wrong. We do want you to do your job. We do want you to make your living. But we're a little gun-shy at this point because we've had some bad instances.
And again, I will reiterate, none of these reports reached me. So I'm actually a little pissed off. To be honest.
Can I have one question?
Yeah.
You mentioned there's going to be a liaison between the production company and the pilots. Is that person going to be on site during this time?
Okay. Oh, yeah.
So it's not going to be like, we got to get a hold of him and he's gone this week.
No.
So that's not to be like, we got a communication breakdown. As long as the channel stay open, sounds like it can probably be a doable thing.
But you've got to remember, there's flying available from an hour before sunrise to an hour after sunset. So that is a long time to have somebody coordinating, having the ability to coordinate. So just keep that in mind.
Is the production company there the entire time?
Yes.
If they clear, if they go home.
I'm assuming they're going to be there 18 hours a day.
When they go home and they clear the runway, then I guess we don't need
her. It's going to be dark when they go home.
Yeah.
Very dark.
Yes,
my
sir.
Service.
Okay. Just from the, throw another brick hole in there.
Sure.
There are homeowners that have, you know, relatively close proximity. I think I'm probably the closest to the airport.
And where are you?
I'm at the south, western runway,
so at the very
right,
end of the
directly
runway.
Over the small hangars.
Right over there, okay.
Directly over the small hangars.
So you're up above us?
Yes.
Okay, got it.
So my only comment that I want to make at this time, I assume that we will have some subsequent meetings that will provide more information.
We will.
Single point of contact regarding what's going on at the airport.
When I get done this evening, if it's possible to have my contact information added to your website, any one of you can call me anytime you have any question and I will tell you any information you have.
And then kind of an outline or however you guys do this on what your plan of action is.
Okay.
Starting forward from June 25th to 3.5 months hence.
Okay.
How many trucks are going to come in, or
whatever
you think is going to be going on.
Okay.
So that we have a heads up.
And and again, I'll leave the open forum to you all. If you would like to either, you're welcome to email me any suggestions of what you think we could do to improve the communication out there, or as pilots, because I am not, so I respect what you guys do, and I know that this is, not just toys that we're playing with. These are life and death when we're flying in the air. So it matters to me.
So
and
what's your email?
It is Karen@scdlocations.com. Karen.
K-A-R-E-N.
That's correct.
All right.
Yes.
During the actual shooting, will there be any type of explosions, gunfire?
No.
I can start describing the road.
You probably want to try this. My name is Robert Phelps. I'm the location manager. I'm moving. This is Tristan, my key assistant. You'll get to know him as well. I've assigned him as my assistant to this location. I'm really happy I'm hearing all this too.
Yes.
Our Fox safety people are going to be all over this. I encourage everybody to come. I'll even let you know when we're having our Fox safety meetings, our initial ones, and I let all of you stand there and say all this in front of the Fox safety person, because I want them to understand what all the concerns are, how to alleviate them. I want a backup guy with the radio too, in case that guy's tired. There's a second one.
I've heard you.
No, we'll, I mean, I wanna pay for whatever it takes to have those people handle this properly.
And I hate to say this, you're gonna issue a note that says the airport's closed.
Correct.
Nobody's gonna read it.
I know.
No, no. And so the port of contact, the person not there, the person going to be on the radio when he flies over.
You're gonna be asking and they'll talk to them, as they're in the air.
And I don't want to.
I don't wanna defend that position because I'm as bad as anybody.
But no, that's the kind of heads up.
If you really want to keep the airport closed.
They won't look for the notice and they are not compelled to call them on the radio.
Yeah, that's the other.
There's no requirement.
There's no requirement for them to actually call you on the radio.
Well.
90% do.
They'll ask if it's a good time to somebody.
No, there's no requirement to do.
No, I can't hear that.
Well, they'll just see that it's a good time.
Well, they will presume.
No, because it's not, gonna be X.
Which makes the critical piece is, you can't arbitrarily call a posse because they're made at any time.
We put the X's down and you just don't throw them.
We've never.
You can't. I was wondering if that might be something that, okay.
There are methods for dealing with that sort of thing. The first one is, rather than X, is you might do the large R.
R.
Which is restricted.
Oh, the restricted for the restricted.
To a restricted, that's pretty noticeable. The other thing is, in addition to a radio, you might want to do signal lists.
But we have already had the discussion about putting up essentially like an air raid siren in the event that someone is not listening to us. So that we can clear the crew and clear everyone so that pilot can come in if for the worst case scenario.
Yeah, we treat it like we're filming on a highway.
Correct.
Even though we're not private. You'd have to just treat it that way. Well, just in general, just quickly also, what's nice about this movie, as someone mentioned it, is first time I've scouted airports and it has nothing to do with planes or helicopters. We're not landing any planes, we're not landing any helicopters. What appealed to us about Agudelsa Airport was the width and length of the runway, because we're recreating the Le Mans racetrack pits. In case anyone doesn't know this, if you already know this, I'll just say it again. But we're essentially in the middle section off of the runway. Yes, we do have to be a certain distance back, which I started to get familiar with, but when we were out on the first day. The set is set back from the runway. We're essentially building a big part of the sequence, the finale of the movie. Our movie's called Le Mans 66. It's based on a true story of Ford being obsessed with beating Ferrari at the 66 Le Mans race and succeeding greatly. Came in first, second, and third. Christian Bale plays Ken Miles. If you're a race car fan, he plays the main driver, and Matt Damon plays Carroll Shelby. And our movie culminates in the Le Mans race where they won first, second, and third. We are not going to France. Le Mans does not look like it looks anymore. We are going to create the grandstands in sort of the middle area. What's nice about Agudelsa was the length of the runway and the smoothness of the runway without a lot of effort to make it feel believable as the racetrack. And the good thing is we don't need to be at each end. There's never any reason to be at either end of this. What we're there to do, and when you see the movie, you'll see visual effects of France and people all around, but we're building the center runway area with a pit so we can do scenes of the cars pulling out, pulling in, the drama of, if you don't know the Le Mans, I'm learning about this too, I'm becoming a race car fan as of a month ago. The Le Mans race is a 24-hour race, and it goes in daytime, and they switch drivers, and they even go at night, and it's whoever that comes in the lead after 24 hours. Hence, we do have a sequence that takes place at night to get the excitement of the fact that it is a 24-hour race. Most of our scenes take place in the daytime, unfortunately, but they've added a little flashback scene with Carroll Shelby racing at Le Mans previously, so there's a little bit of more night work added, which I should talk about. We actually, instead of the four midnights that got noted on your, we do hope to be able to go till 2 a.m. on two Fridays. We'll put them on the Fridays, hopefully make that all go down a little easier. Our race car coordinator wanted me to reiterate that these aren't race cars. This is not going to sound like NASCAR race cars. This is us queuing specially built cars that have small block engines in them.
that are for our purposes. What it is, we're gonna see all the action in the pits and the stands and the conflict Enzo Ferrari and Ford and they're all and all this stuff of pulling in and out. But then visual effects will put in the French countryside and the Dunlop tire in the distance and all of that. This is strictly to be able to cut down on the expensive visual effects of the cars racing toward the pits and then past the pits. So if you're having a dialogue scene, maybe the scene is someone pulling into the pits and you want to cue a car enough distance back for him to gain enough speed. And they won't even be driving as fast as they do in real life. They're going 200 miles past the pits in real life. They'll probably be going 90 past the set. But you stage them down there, you cue the car, they go past, cut, pull everything off, reset. So it's strictly just the beauty of being able to have that length of that runway and to be able to kind of look up it and down it, but everything else around it will be visual effects after the fact. A couple of things, we do want to feel like we're part of the community in a situation like this and even open it up to people who live around here, want to be extras in the movie, because we do have scenes of people in the stands watching the excitement of the race. You have to look like you're from the 1960s though. Or you don't have to go through hair and makeup or possibly even put a 60s shirt on or something. But we'll talk more about that, but we want to open that up we're going to film until October, so it's still a ways away in that sense. But the reason for the big chunk of time is giving our construction crew, and they're thrilled that we're picking Agua Dulce. A lot of them live out here. The other option we were maybe going to shoot for that was El Toro, which yeah. I'm so glad we're not down in El Toro. That's nowhere near where any of us live. But they need enough time to build this set. So that's why we picked. We backed it up a number of weeks from the first shoot day to which ended up, we're trying to accommodate them with a June 25th start of just even just being out there starting to offload and build the set. But the actual shoot days are, like I said, are 11 shoot days. We end on a Monday, which is nice too, so our very last shoot day will be a daytime scene. So when we're finally, what's nice too, when you're at a location for a long amount of time, which is a nice break for us, we're not on the move every day to a new location. You know, we stay in place. What I love about this too is this is one of those rare locations where you don't see anything except what you're looking at. Matt's Damon's trailer can be right here. You never see it the whole movie. So everything can be close behind us, close to the set. I feel like there's probably enough room for crew cars, equipment. There's not going to be a ton, each night there's not going to be a ton of get back to the set and da, 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 da. Until that last day, of course, when everybody has to vacate. I don't know. Any other questions?
How do you think you're going to build this set?
Where is it positioned?
Where are you getting materials there?
Wow, I'm not sure exactly how to describe that, Tristan. Do you know how to describe how the building is set? I just know it takes a while.
Well, you have two options. One is you come in the front gate and cross the road.
Oh, how you're getting back into that. That's more. Have you talked about the logistics?
Actually, the honest answer is that we have not come up, we have not finished the final plan of their path. That was a discussion that was an internal discussion that we haven't finished at the airport because we're still working on it. But the intention is they will have a very specific map of this is where you drive, this is where you do not, this is where you can put your equipment, this is where you cannot. And it will be with the purpose and intention to make sure that they are as tight of a box as we could possibly keep them to keep as much of the airport open and safe in the event someone to come in unexpectedly.
Yes. Or just for
people. But
you know, unexpected people is
for you absolutely. For you guys absolutely. But I say that meaning that we're cognizant of the fact that it is not only you. Mm-hmm. And so
the odds of you getting somebody else are slim.
Well, I think the first month there's gonna be people wandering in, flying in. After the first month,
word spreads.
After the first month, the schools are all going to know, everybody's going to, the word will be out that it's closed. But for the first, at least 2 weeks, it's going to be the,
most of those guys are on the radio.
Yeah.
Right.
So we don't have a problem letting everyone in town know what's happening. And, I definitely, this is just the start of these conversations. I encourage, what we do is we want to have separate conversations with the people that really do live directly there that might be more effective
Speaking of bringing in all the equipment and material, being a small town, a two-lane town.
Yes.
Staggering, you know, scheduling, driving in, respecting our speed limits, you know, just knowing that it's a small community and there are horses and children, but a massive traffic transport at one time would not be a good thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Typically with projects like this, and we've done quite a few over my years in the industry, I have always been surprised at how many days I'm standing around going, you guys are paying for this? I'm not even here. So my experience is that on occasion, when we're starting big projects like this, we have maybe a couple of hours during a morning when the delivery trucks are coming in, they're off of
They stagger, the departments want to stagger their hours anyway, so they're not stepping on each other.
That's correct.
But I like putting up separate slope signs for the duration. We've done it before on projects.
Yeah.
The other issue is that all the people that belong to the airport have coded in.
Correct.
But if you have somebody at the gate, there are issues about them not coming in, well, yeah, I can't hear you. I'm sorry, it's closed. So is there some way to do that?
That's poor communication of the security guards.
I want to be consistent with who we assign to the gate.
Yeah.
I think that's a big thing, as far as having manpower that we're leaving, that we have in charge and so forth. It's not like somebody one day and somebody else. We have a consistent person.
Because they get to know everybody. And that person is the one that's always there. Right? Yeah. They have a list. Let's treat it like that.
Yeah.
Okay. Question next time.
I think it would be good if you had two more meetings. Have a meeting over at the airport, invite all the pilots, and then also have a community meeting, put it out to the community. We can do that through Facebook.
Sure.
To take care of neighbor concerns.
Yep.
Because there are neighbors that aren't here tonight that may have some concerns. So I think do those two meetings and then we're good.
Yep. Sure.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
Definitely. Yeah.
But I think you are now aware of some of the potential issues.
Yeah.
And I think the pilots are aware of the big picture.
Yeah, I want to make sure everyone knew what the scope is, what we're building, when. Yeah.
Does that mean that we don't get to drive a GT40 in a Ferrari?
I want to treat this like, I mean, we're filming in your neighborhood, the people with the hangers, the people that are close.
That's good.
I want you to feel like there's never a sense of...
So look into that car.
You can't
look
into that
car. You said they're going to be underpowered cars.
They're not going to be a...
We want the real thing.
Oh. Yeah, yes, none of these low motor vehicles.
Well, I was about to say we have those on this movie too, but I'm not even sure if we do have those on this movie. We have to build like some that we have to crash. That look like they have engines in them.
There's one up there at Pasadena, right?
I want to be with the people that live, that have the hangars. You can always feel like you can come and visit and we get to know who you are.
This is not a
No, it'll be a lot of interesting things to watch. And yes, probably at some point you get to know everybody and you say, can I sit in the car? I can't promise it, but not the picture car guy.
I'll note that we are guests in this neighborhood, and basically we represent the next film company that comes in.
That's from what we've heard,
it's been unfortunate. I filmed at airports, I filmed at Ontario, and some other airports, and I know it's not just like filming in a house. It's a specialty location, and communication is the number one thing with everything.
interior work.
But anyway, yeah, no, that's the biggest thing is, you know, understanding, and the other key too is that if something is out, if, you know, somebody's speeding or whatever, I want to make sure that that never even happens. We have signage, you know, we have safety meetings constantly with all the departments, you know, because there's no excuses.
Yeah.
It might also be good to have someone in the community where if people have concerns, you've got one person to deal with instead of 50 phone calls or emails.
I mean, as in like a community?
That's what she is, right?
Yeah.
As Candy, what is Candy?
I'm just film for our town.
Is that for our region? You're it?
Yeah, so it would be nice to have.
If there's somebody who's got issues and they call you,
yes,
then you will call.
Instead of getting 50 phone calls.
Or me if it's something that's not, you know, that's just like, if I give a quick answer to it.
Exchange contact information.
We'll put plenty of numbers out there for people to contact.
Yeah, I mean, there'll be a specific person for the extras casting.
But.
I always hate getting those calls. It's not my problem.
I know from an airport point of view, we were really pretty tolerant of film shoots.
That's absolutely correct.
But when we hear 4 months, you know, we just want to have a few ground rules.
No, exactly. Yeah, it's.
You know, a week?
Yeah.
A week is even a long time.
We get long.
Yeah, they usually.
So, you know, a day in and out, we can tolerate that. But we just, and I'm thankful that you came and kind of.
Sounds like there's still issues that need to be discussed, but they're issues that pertain primarily to the operation of the airport, the pilot's situation.
Make sure that's.
So, well, for you will be long periods of time, there will be nothing wrong at the airport, not a free run of everything, punctuated by moments that are catching by surprise when someone's going to expect you to run them.
Yeah.
And that's going to be the problem, is you're going to be bored thinking nothing's going on, and two planes are popping. And sitting in a truck drives across the runway and everything falls apart.
It's almost production assistants that's their only job is to just keep an eye on what's on the runway at all times.
Right.
There's some guy left something down at that end. Hey, tell them, you know, it's like, that's all they do. I just have to tell my producer that we need like a couple people that just, that's all they're doing.
Yeah. But it's going to be tempting to park stuff on the runway because it'll be long
exactly.
Time when nothing's happening.
Right, I'll see
when
you
expect
it.
You know, by 4 o'clock, everybody wants to go.
Yeah, no, unfortunately, we'll designate all that off to the sides, but you're right, you have to have people.
And also, with, you know, with trash and debris and stuff, because I know the thought is that that stuff, just that is a big thing, that just, you know, a cap or a piece of trash.
Before you
leave.
There's still a 4-foot piece of rebar next to the runway to grow in. It's been annoying me.
It's sticking out.
They put it in last week.
We put it in last week, 10 days ago.
Yes.
You have to hop over the hill.
Are you serious?
Mm-hmm. It's in the middle of all your marks on the ground.
Too close to the.
It's like.
Oh.
Well, no,
it's at 15.
Was it left?
Oh, it's
right?
In 15 feet.
You know, when I'm going to tell you honestly, when I kicked them off the runway, they were running. They may have missed it.
They started with the rebar and then replaced it with the painting on the ground.
Correct.
Because they told them they could keep the rebar there.
That's right. So they may have things.
Okay.
So then we'll have a contact person that we will then coordinate.
You gotta tell them.
Yes.
Yes.
And again, in lieu of us figuring out exactly who that is, again, you are welcome to call me for any question at any time.
My expectation here is you're going to take all of who's the one to give up the main email and telephone number, and at some point, fairly soon, you're going to call me and we'll meet over at the airport.
That was my intention.
So we figure out an honest operation plan.
My intention and my plan was to request the tenant or the owners, everyone's email addresses, or request that the airport send out to everyone a information email saying, please come. Talk to Karen about this film.
You do. It's a fair amount of very, very experienced operations.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
And would you anticipate that meeting happening?
I hadn't had an exact date yet. I was honestly waiting to see how this evening went and to figure out what I was going to learn. My goal is, I'll try to get that. How quickly would you like it?
soon because it's tomorrow.
So I will do my best effort to make that happen at the beginning of next week. Is that acceptable?
You may have to, I'll be scouting again, but you can attend that.
Any more questions?
And then you're gonna have a meeting with the neighbors too?
Yes, we will also send out a notice to the, all the residents who have requested to be on the notification list for filming at the airport.
Okay, and that'll be done ahead of time so they've got some time to.
That is correct.
Right.
Okay.
And we've already had some dialogue, myself and production about, addressing, impact of the people, the, our neighbors right there at the airport. The ones that really, really, really will be, seeing the activity on a daily basis.
Yeah, is this a done deal, what's gonna happen, or is it still in the works?
No, it's, that's where we've chosen to go.
It's a done deal.
The night filming.
For night?
Yes.
Yes.
Not to affect me, but, you said two nights, till 2 AM or?
Yes.
What's the full, what do you?
If I may.
No, go ahead.
What we initially, the purpose that we actually came here this evening, was we originally had requested, because we are only allowed to film at the airport until 10 PM. We have to be 100% gone by 10 PM. Or we can do what is called a signature survey, and we can petition through signatures to be extended from 10 PM to midnight. The caveat to that is that all of the filming that takes place between 10 PM and midnight must occur inside. And then the last truck or car, taillights is what we call it, must be done by midnight. So what we're requesting is that we be able to film until, originally it was midnight, for 4 days.
Mm-hmm.
And now from what I understand.
Outside.
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 Yes.
That's the change.
Yes, outside.
Yeah.
That is correct. So we would, essentially what would happen, and what that really means, is for that midnight extension. When we have to be taillights by 10 PM, that means that production shuts down around 8:30. Everyone does their work to clean up, wrap and close the set, so that the last car, their taillights are 10 PM. By requesting going to midnight, what that allows us to do is actually continue to film until around 10 or 10:30 PM, and then spend the rest of that time to pack up and send everyone home. So the impact will not be, we're not blowing things up at midnight. We're not, and
it's the personal cars leaving.
That is correct.
Most equipment will stay because we'll be back the next day.
Correct.
You're not running any cars at midnight or?
Pardon?
Race scenes at midnight?
No.
No, no, no.
Oh, well,
so
not on the 2 AM ones, potentially a car will go till midnight.
So since our original request, there have been some script changes, and apparently there were two additional days that have been added to the schedule, and correct me if I'm wrong.
That's correct.
Two additional days that have been added to the schedule, and those 2 days we are requesting to film until midnight, and then go home between midnight and 2.
And those will be on a Friday night.
And they will be Friday nights.
We're gonna put those on the Friday too.
Yeah. Yeah. So that is the official request of the purpose that we have come to.
It's 2 extra days of airport being closed too.
Well, that was always 11. No, it was turning two of the shorter days.
So
yeah, it's still 11.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
yeah. It just became more of
okay.
A night sequence.
So 2 additional days just for that.
Yeah.
Correct.
So I think the community members, the neighbors, are going to be the ones who are going to be most impacted by that.
Right.
So I think that is where you need to
definitely
coordinate noticing them. Because
we'll be watching.
We'll be having a hangover.
We're
going to go to each hangar.
Everyone's going to run out their hangar.
What do you got?
pork owners or painter owners.
I do want to point out that this film got the California Film Incentive. It was originally supposed to shoot in Georgia, so it's creating the great thing. It's all the jobs that it is creating for our state here. Which I also want to, because I'll be out here a bunch, I'd like to get like a list of the local food places and so forth.
It's a short list.
I mean, I know it's a short list, but it's you know what, it's if we can
well
frequent.
They expect my art department to provide them with all the local.
Yeah.
Where do I go get this? Where do I go?
Yeah. So, but it's you know what, if any money that we can put into the community, it's, you know, I think it's always a good thing wherever we go.
We have a PayPal account on the.
Good. We will still go to Georgia for 4 days to shoot the Laval Rose because they looked close enough to France. Mm-hmm. Not quite France, but better than the roads here.
A little
different. Yeah, it's more green for those scenes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
If you need a film in this building for any reason.
Lovely building.
What do we do? Like extra casting in here.
We're trying to build a new building. We're trying to raise money.
Oh, I saw that. That's
the answer. So anything you wish to do?
That's right.
Not a problem.
I love it. Mm-hmm. I love it.
Okay,
I love
we
it.
We can have the meetings here.
That's right.
Have meetings here. Maybe we can serve them lunch. I don't know.
That's space we look for.
Is it worth getting
I
don't
know, but I think I know you, and I would think
you
would
think
I
okay.
Thank you so much for coming.
All right, thank
you
very much.
Thank
all right, we're going to wrap this meeting up. Somebody smell small?
You.
Most of your turn.
I second the motion to adjourn.
Okay.
Right.
One committee meeting important.
Oh,
and
it's important.
It's a little concerning, and I don't know how many people are aware of it, but I had one of our customers who's trying to build a house in Davenport, Wagonwell Road off of Davenport. Actually, right now he lives in Hawaii. He alerts me to what Governor Brown signed into law, and it's called the California's New Water Law, 55 gallons per person per day. That's the new law, it's already been signed in. And by 2030, it's going
to
drive
down.
Yeah,
it doesn't take effect until 2022.
2025.
But in 2035.
Nobody knows.
55.
Nobody
can only consume 55 gallons a day.
But it's
inside.
Inside.
Per person,
so
but.
That's per person, though. So how are they going to keep track of how many per persons are in a per house?
This is more for water agencies than it is for individual well owners.
As water stewards, as the water stewardship person, I just want to make you aware that our governors, our king is thinking about our concern.
But
it's
it may lower our well yield requirement. If
that's
we only are going to be able to use 55 gallons, we don't need.
We're
going to
try
to
get some money.
100 gallons. Because
now the governor says this. We've been saying this all along. Everybody uses 50 to 60 gallons per person per day. And they poo-pooed us, you know, that's why they need 3,000 gallons a day.
Right.
Well, now it's